So when I heard that, it was like $20 billion of budget slated for that. So I sat up straight and went, holy moly, that's where we need to be.
Right.
They said the next thing was, if you're serious about doing work in Afghanistan, you must show up at a meeting next April. This was like February, in either Kandahar or Kabul. And I remember being with a couple of guys from my office who do marketing, and looked at each other and went, uh-oh, one of us has to go to Kabul or Kandahar. And one of them said, I'll go. And I was like, wow, I'm not going to make you go, but I sure would be grateful if you would go.
Right.
So, of course, we had no clue what to do. And it took some time for us to find out like how to get them there. But the cost was very, it was high. It was very expensive.
Yep.
We had to have a security company pick him up at the airport, take him to the meeting, to the hotel, and then back to the airport. He literally was there for like 2 nights in one day.
Okay.
And all he did was attend that meeting. And so from that meeting came people, he met Afghan companies. And we partnered with a couple of them. And right away, we got work with the Army Corps of Engineers as a subcontractor to these two Afghan companies.
Really?
And then later, one of the Afghan company owners who lived in Arlington, Virginia, or he lived in Virginia, his office was actually in Rosslyn, Virginia. He became a real ally and mentor. And he was doing about $100 million a year, so he wasn't small anymore. And he said, you are in 8A and you're small and you're a woman-owned small business. You can win the small business set-asides that I cannot win. And you go in as prime and I'll help you and I'll be your sub. And I said, gosh, Aziz, I don't think we can win that. We don't have the bonding capacity and
Right.
this contract's too large, blah, 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 blah. But, I'll try anything once. So we threw it at the wall and it stuck. And we got the 8A set-aside for, I think it was the 500 million or the 600 million. Naturally, the real task orders only didn't even add up to 10 million. They were about 6 million, but not, people get excited when they hear the 500
No, of
million and 6
course.
million. That's
Right.
really, the outer limit of what the government would spend on probably multiple contracts that are similar. So we won that. We won that with them as our sub. And initially, we got no task orders. And then eventually, I just made marketing trips to Kabul at least once or twice a year. The Afghan partner would basically tell me when to come. He'd say, okay, you need to come back. And he would take care of my security and give me a guard and a driver and all that. And initially, I'd stay in hotels. And later, I started staying in his expat compound because I felt that it was safer. He had 28 armed guards. And yeah, that's how it happened. So that's how we met this guy. And we became, now we'd probably be lifelong friends. Now I'm on the board of the American University of Afghanistan. And the last project we did was a dormitory for them, for women, 200 beds. And we designed and built it with this Afghan partner, and it was hugely successful. And so, yeah, you just gotta keep putting one foot in front of the other, and one opportunity leads to another. And that opportunity led to, so we did three task orders that involved work in five different facilities in Afghanistan as prime. Before that, we've been working as a sub on other stuff, primarily for the Afghan army, the Afghan police, but our client was U.S. Army Corps, and our client was actually the prime who was then working for the U.S. Army Corps. We also did a hospital and a clinic, also for U.S. Army Corps as a sub.
From ground up.
No, these were, I think, renovations and additions. I'm researching. It was a while ago. It was 10 years ago. I can't remember, but I don't think they were new from the ground up. And in fact, four of the five facilities we worked on as prime were not new either. They were renovations to existing buildings. And the fifth one was new from the ground up, the dormitory. So next thing we know, as a result of that work, we now had good qualifications for international work. We were able to win this architecture and engineering design only, because the one in Afghanistan was design build, design only worldwide IDIQ for USAID. And that has taken us in the last 3 years to El Salvador, Haiti, Beirut, Lebanon, Jordan, Tanzania, Zambia, Congo, Kosovo, Burkina Faso, Afghanistan, and looks like we may be going to Morocco soon. So on some task orders. So and they're mostly smaller task orders. They haven't been huge. The one in Zambia is the largest one. We're going to have, that's a 4-year engagement, and we will have full-time employees on the ground in Zambia that we've already hired and kicked that off. I just spent the whole month of February there.
Did you really?
Renting office space and getting to know the new staff that we hired. And beautiful country, beautiful people. I really loved it. So we were talking about all the multiple countries that we've been in. Mostly they've been small task orders, except for this now Zambian one.
And then you said that's the one that you like the most, that country.
Well, yeah.
What was it? Which country was it?
Wonderful. I mean, we went, like, on the weekends, you get a day off, and we went to a baby elephant orphanage, and then we went to Victoria Falls, and then we did a little one-day safari in another part of the country. So it was beautiful. Zambia. If you ever get a chance to go to Zambia, you should definitely jump.
Actually, you know, I am. When I started a company when I was in college, and we were doing like IT stuff, software apps. My partner was from Burkina Faso.
Oh wow!
And I heard you mention that name, so that
was embassy in Ouagadougou.
Yeah, that's funny. My partner's from Burkina Faso, so I you know, I do know. It's funny. I know where it's at, and you know, so I have. But I was working with a contracting an Ostabu here for the Navy. And they moved over to Djibouti, Africa, to do work over there.
Really?
Yeah, apparently we're building two military facilities over there in Djibouti.
There's a lot. Yeah, I hear there's a lot going on in Djibouti.
Yeah. So he moved over there.
The other thing that I think your audience would want to know is that we've been told this a bunch of times, that it's not enough to go to Washington, D.C. You have to market to the missions, because they have their own budgets, and they're often going to be very involved in the decision about who to hire, if not directly, then indirectly through somebody, a contracting officer in Washington, D.C. But they also have their own contracting officers, and they do hire directly from the missions. So there's a group that you all should know about, which is the SBAIC, the Small Business Association of International Companies, primarily USAID contractors. And they did recently, in conjunction with USAID, they did a small business conference. And yeah, I can't say enough good things about the conferences, because that's where you really meet the people. So we flew to South Africa a couple years ago, me and a woman here from the company who's the CAO. And, you know, of course, it's expensive and far away. I mean, that's the thing. You've got to be ready to really spend some money on marketing.
Right.
And we met all the missions were there, especially African missions. And, you know, they were represented, and we got to meet them, and it was set up like in an exhibit hall, and you literally went from booth to booth. And then we were there a couple of days with different kind of educational panels, listening to people who do this stuff for a living and just learning from companies who are doing it more so, you know, a lot, been doing it a lot longer than we have and more of it than we are. So it was extremely educational, and we met some folks there.